Howard Callahan with the Department of Ag's Nutrient Management Program. I think I see a lot of faces that I see every year, but again, I'm down in the office in Talbot County. I do Talbot, Queen Anne's, and Kent County. So I get around, see a lot of you. I'm gonna go through several things as far as Nutrient Management Program is concerned, and we'll touch on every one of them slightly. If you got questions, you're more than welcome to ask them. Not a problem. And again, there's some handouts going around of my PowerPoint, so it's something maybe you want to take home, you want to look at later, maybe you don't. Big thing right now is AIRs, the annual implementation reports, nice pretty green forms. Everybody got them right after the first of the year, hopefully if you needed one. They were due March 1, so if you're thinking, I didn't think I did one, you know you've done one in the past, better find somebody. Needless to say, you'll get an unfriendly reminder from us in 2 or 3 weeks if you didn't do it. That basically gives you an opportunity to do it. Again, looks just like last year, a few little questions different, but not much difference. Phosphorus management tool, PMT, that's been a hot topic for a couple years. Basically, there was regulations changed in 2015 that is phasing this into effect. One immediate thing, which doesn't affect most of us, is if you have a soil test phosphorus level of 500 or greater on a FIV scale, you have been immediately banned from applying any additional phosphorus to that site, period. So that's in place right now. The tool itself is getting phased in over 7 years. Again, from 2015 to 2022 is the plan to have it fully implemented. Crop years 2016 and 17, which we're in, basically if excessive soil test phosphorus levels, and that is 150 or greater, are part of your management and you're still trying to apply phosphorus, your consultant's running the phosphorus site index, PSI, currently to justify that. For 16 and 17, the requirement is they're going to run both tools, compare them apples to apples, so you can see if and when I have to implement PMT, what, if any, change may I have to make. It's kind of getting you prepared. So it's educational in a sense. Again, trying to provide you with where you're going. Another thing is, consultants had to calculate an average soil FIV because that's basically putting you in a tier group of an implementation phase-in schedule. In other words, everybody's not going to implement PMT in the same time frame under the same parameters. A little confusing, I know, but I'll go into this a little more. So in a nutshell, if you've got excessive phosphorus levels, you're still using phosphorus sources on those. So in your plan, your consultant should be calculating this average FIV, and all it is taking all your soil tests that you have that are 150 and above, adding them together, dividing by that number of samples is all it is. So if you got a 150 and a 250, you add them together, you divide by 2, hopefully you come out with 200. That's your average FIV in this scenario. That's just for implementation purposes. Again, the PMT may change some requirements that you have to implement because it's potentially could be more restrictive, and it may not be. One big player in that is subsurface drainage or water. Basically, it coincides with fields with high water tables, a lot of ditches, got tile wells in. In other words, conduits to get into something to water in a short time frame to some degree are considered a greater risk. Again, it coincides a lot on the lower shore. Again, it's where we got a lot of poultry and a lot of high P soil. So it's going to have some impact on some people. It's going to be more severe, at least in my opinion, the very lower shore, the last three counties down, where there's a lot of poultry, a lot of more poorly drained soils, a lot of ditches.
Before you get too far away from
it. Yes, sir.
So when you're calculating that tier group, is that for the whole farm operation?
The question was, when you're calculating the tier group, which is going to set you up on the implementation schedule, the question was, is that done per farm or per your whole operation? And the answer is per your whole operation. It's everything that's under your nutrient management plan. It's going to say, Mr. Greg Hahn, farmer, is going to implement, this is his average for his entire operation, and he's going to implement on this schedule that I'm going to hedge you into.
I'm trying to explain to guys that, you know, if you got 170 fields, which is a large operation, you got a couple fields really, you know, that are high, it's not going to affect you much. But if you're just one farm in your operation and you got one field, then, you know, the lower number of fields, you know, the more money
The comment is making that the guy's got lots of fields was potentially less of an impact because you think of the dilution factor, I guess is what you're getting at. But what you got to remember, it's only looking at the fields over 150. So he may have 170 fields, but he may only have 10 over 150. So the focus is on those 10. And again, when you have to implement PMT or PSI, it's only those 10 because the rest are less than 150. No relationship. Hopefully that didn't confuse you.
To help with that,
it's only when you start using the PMT.
Correct. It's just a phasing schedule.
Not how the PMT is actually going to be rated on you.
Correct. Yeah. The comment was made that average FIV does not change the impact of what PMT may or may not have on you. It's just putting you on the schedule to say we got to start getting here, or we're going to get a little more time to get there. It's kind of the intent behind it. Again, just a quick little rehash. If you're looking at soil tests on an FIV scale, needless to say, if you're 0 to 25, you're considered low, most likely going to get a response, blah, blah, blah. 100 or greater is considered excessive for crop production. In most cases, they're predicting you're not going to get an agronomic response. Again, in the phosphorus, PSI, PMT, regulatory world, at this point, we're not concerned until you're 150 or greater. So in logic, we're 50% higher than what you needed for crop production. And now it's just going, and what we're doing is we're getting away from crop production and we're looking at it, what's the environmental risk in a sense on this site that's got excessive soil test phosphorus, and we're still trying to put phosphorus on it for whatever reason. So again, the average FIV 150 or greater requires a PSI or PMT if you're still trying to put phosphorus on. Basically, you're doing it before you do it. A field with, again, reiterate, if it's over 500, you don't get the option to run the tool. That supposedly is only while we're in the transitioning phase to get into 2022, and then subject to change, I'm sure. But in reality, if you're 500, you probably don't need to be putting phosphorus on it. And there doesn't seem to be a lot, but I'm going to go through some of that again in a little bit. Again, part of that process when that regulation was passed in 2015 about heading into PMT required consultants, plan writers, to submit phosphorus soil test levels to the department. So some of you probably heard about that. Some of you probably got excited about that and think, oh my God, you know, everything's going on. But it was a requirement. We've gotten a lot of that. We haven't gotten all of that. But anyhow, we now think we have a better synopsis of what soil test phosphorus levels are in a region or in a county to some degree, better than what we've had in the past. Before, it was some speculation. So again, that actually was due September 30th of 2015. So we're a year and a half away from that. So we've gotten a lot of that. We're still working on trying to get a little more. Again, the data is used to just to help identify to some degree where the excessive levels are. It was gathered anonymously. So in other words, when your consultant sent information in about your farm, my farm, whoever he was working with, he was just sending in data that said, it's in Talbot County, it's 25 acres, it's in this zip code, and here's my soil test phosphorus FIV level. I think I didn't miss anything, unless it was acres, maybe acres. So your samples, if your consultant's doing multiple farms, or maybe if it's only doing yours, they're all just mixed on this spreadsheet that said they're in this county, here's my levels, here's the acres. You're putting in the high ones, the low ones, everything you've got. And then separately, they were sending in another sheet that said, within what I have sent in, I have Greg Holland, the farmer, I have Howard Callahan, the farmer, I have Dan Schwaniger, the farmer, I've sent you their stuff. So we got a list over here. We're checking off names compared to what we've got on record to say we've gotten the data somewhere in this pile of over here for this farmer, and this farmer. So we're checking it off to some degree. The requirement, again, is it's supposed to be done again in 6 years. So it'll be coming again, forthcoming. Again, data is gathered with consultants, submitted anonymously, so it's where we are. As of January of 2017, so 2 months ago, looking at acres that were submitted on the 2004 annual implementation reports, because when we started this in 15, that was the latest data we had, we're anticipating 1.2 million plus acres of soils, farms, cropland out there looking for soil data. At this point, or as of January, we had a little over a million. So 85% roughly, we've got those acres. So now the big thing is we're trying to figure out where the other 15% are and how we get them. Of that, the number of fields submitted was 73,000. Over 150, in other words, less than 150, was almost 80% of that. Between 150 and 499, which are the ones that PSI or PMT is going to be a player on, was 19%. Over FIV of 500 is 1.6%. Just to relate that into acres. 79% of the acre across the state, based on what was submitted, not being impacted at all, represented 858,000 acres, less than 150. The 20% was roughly 225,000 acres that are going to be using the PSI, going to the PMT. And again, we're taking incremental things. We're working towards trying to get the other. Needless to say, if your name showed up that we didn't think we got your data, you probably either have had a visit or you're getting one. Because we're trying to figure out why. And sometimes we're collecting data that way. Sometimes we can't really answer why we didn't have it. But we're doing our best to get it. And I hate to say it, but we'll probably never get it all. But it's what we've got to work with. Just to break it down a little more to what I'll say our world, this is what categorized we're calling the upper and the mid-eastern shore, which encompasses Cecil, Kent, Queen Anne's, Talbot, Carolina, Dorchester counties. It's kind of my world to some degree, minus Cecil and Dorchester, but it's kind of the upper part of the shore, getting away from the chicken world, but looking at the rest of the shore. Again, 519,000 acres is what we thought we were looking for. We got a little better than 470,000, which was 90%. So we got a big part of that. Of that, 83%+ less than 150, no impact. 16% between 150 and 499, and 0.25% greater than 500. So you can see we don't have a lot of the really high ones in this region. Again, relating on acres, for the same region, again, looking at that mid to upper shore, same counties, 83% of the acreage, again, not impacted. That represents 392,000+ acres. 16.5%, 77,000 plus are over 150. So the big question came up, and you know, it's come up in the past, is like, we got all this poultry litter. I mean, that's what the focus seems to be, you know, with phosphorus in it, and what are we going to do with it? We ain't going to have no home for it, you know. So we tried to, from this data that we've collected, tried to make some generalizations in a sense. So basically all they did was said, again, looking at 2015 AIR data, so now we've gone from 14 to 15, but it seems to be trending. There was almost 384,000 tons of chicken litter that was used or needed to be used in that year in the state. Just taking a modest assumption and said, well, if we put 2 tons to the acre, which seems like a common reasonable rate, you know, if you ask 10 people, 9 of them are going to tell you, I'll put 2 tons to the acre, you know. Which basically says we would need a little more than 191,000, almost 192,000 acres to ultimately give that a home. Again, if you look just at the upper shore, which is now Cecil, Kent, and Queen Anne's, kind of where we're at, we had 237,000 plus acres, 90%, that are less than 150, which ultimately says this manure can go on there with no questions asked because they don't need a phosphorus site index or a PMT because it's less than 150. 75% from the midshore, looking at 155,000 acres, from Talbot, Carolina, and Dorchester, below 150. If you look at the lower shore, Somerset, Wicomico, Worcester, there was only 42,000 acres less than 150. So again, if you just look from the whole eastern shore, there's 435,000 acres that are totally below 150 FIV that have no phosphorus limitations, restrictions, short-term anyhow, for PSI, PMT. So you can see this is more than twice what this is. So the generalization is being made. We got a home for it. Here, even on the eastern shore, we may have to relocate some of it, don't get me wrong. And that's kind of what we're hanging our hat on at this point, is anticipation, some relocation, definitely from the lower shore. And in a perfect world, the closer you can keep it to from point A to point B, the less cost is involved. So just to get away from that slightly, still talking about PMT and the tier group data. Again, we had 1,661 operations that have reported. It represents they got at least one field that's 150 or greater, because anybody that was over 150 had to submit something. So it's not every farm. If you don't have any over 150, then you're not part of the tier group. You know, that we're not expecting anything from that. Again, it represents 11,000 plus fields. Again, it's only something that's done for the transition. And it represented 187,000 acres is what was came into us. And again, what's a tier group? It's basically just putting you in an implementation phase-in schedule to some degree. Again, not all operations that have to implement are going to be implementing or not regulated under the same time frame. Timing is determined by your individual average FIV 150 plus. Again, like I said earlier, you add the fields that are 150 or greater, and you divide by those number of fields. So it's not a true weighted average. It's not high and low together. It's all the highs averaged together. And you're basically going to get put in a tier group A, B, or C, which is going to implement, is going to phase in your implementation schedule. Again, it's done one time, just set you up on the tier, get you on the schedule. The anticipation is we never have to do it again. If you're in tier group A, basically you're the lower of the averages of the 150 plus. So if you're between, if your average comes out between 150 and 300, you're in tier group A, which basically says you don't have to start using or implementing PMT to any degree until 2020. And we're ultimately all going to get to 2022. So the logic is these are the ones that are going to have to make the potentially less change. So they're giving them more time to keep doing what you're doing. And then we're going to start phasing it in. So again, between 20 and 22, 3 years, there's going to be some gradual changes if changes need to be made. Again, 1,300 operations in that category, 8,000 fields, 122,000 plus acres. Again, 79% of what we got are falling in what I call tier group A, the lower risk. Tier group B is nothing more than the ones with the next level. So now their average over 150 was between 300 and 450. So they're going to start implementing in 2009. They're going to start implementing a year sooner, but it's on a graduated scale of where we're going in 2022. Of that, 252 operations, 2,800 fields, 54,000 acres, 15% of what was reported to us fell into that category. Tier group C are the ones that got an average that's 450 or greater. Again, they're going to start implementing in 2018. If you remember back to the beginning, 2016, 2017, comparisons, education. This group is going to start phasing in a little bit of restriction, assuming they're going to have to make a change in 2018. Again, they're going to have 5 years, which is the difference between 2018 and 2022 when we're anticipated to be fully in implementation. It's only 96 operations, 700 fields, almost 11,000 acres, 6% of what was reported. This is the same data, but kind of in a table. Maybe helps you follow it a little better. In a nutshell, 2016, 2017, you see PSI/PMT. That's everybody. Education, do them both. See where we're at. Compare this one to that one. See if something's different. If you're tier group C, that was the ones with the highest levels, 450 plus, they're going to start implementing in 2018 under tier management phase one. That's where you see transition management phase one, phase two. So they're starting something in 2018 where you get down here to the tier A, which was the 150 to 300. See, they're still doing PSI, PSI for two more years. They're going to start tier one in 2022. So they're going to make the changes. Ultimately, we're all trying to get to here. 2022, we're all doing PMT, PMT, PMT. So tier one, transition phase one, is a step towards PMT. And you see, you got 2 years of one, then they went to 2 years of two, then you went to PMT. The logic is, this may cut you off. Assuming you're over here at 2 tons of chicken litter, or 3 tons today, we're going to wean you back, try to cut you back, and in theory, give an opportunity to find a home for that manure you've been using to go somewhere else. I mean, that's the intent of this. instead of everybody trying to say, we all got to do it, we all know what we're going to do with the manure, you know, at the same time. So that's just the phase in approach in a table form. Again, when we get to PMT, full implementation in 2022, this is where we're going to be. So again, if you run the PMT, and it's going to put you in a category that says what you're doing under this site, under this conditions, under this soil test is a low risk, a medium risk, and a high risk. That's nothing more than trying to categorize what someone thinks is the risk of phosphorus leaving your field and getting to the water. It's got no inclination of how much it is. It's a lot, a little. It's looking at all the site conditions specific to your situation and putting you in the category. So, and they mean something different in the transition versus what they're going to mean when we get to PMT. So it's a weaning down effect. That's really what it's doing. So if you do PMT today or 5 years from now and you come out as a low risk, ultimately you're going to end up with a 3-year crop phosphorus removal restriction. This is 2022 PMT, which basically is saying I can put all my phosphorus on today for my crops that I anticipate to grow for the next 3 years. And I can do it anytime I want in that 3-year period. So you got a phosphorus restriction. It's limiting you to that, but it's not saying you can't choose to put it all on day one. You know, maybe when I plant corn, for an example. But you would have a restriction that says I can't put any more in year two and year three. If you're low risk and in the phase in, it's really no different, if that makes any sense. It's the people with the higher risk. For an example, just jump down to the high risk. If you run PMT or your consultant and your risk is high, high potential for loss from this site based on what you've got going on, when you get to PMT, it's cutting you off. It says you're going to zero. Okay, no pig. In the transition, phase one, you remember they're going to start that guy in 2018, I think it was. He's going to start in phase one. It's going to limit him to 1 year's worth of crop removal. They're going to do that for 2 years. They're going to cut you down to half of that for 2 years, and then they're going to cut you down to zero, if that's your scenario. If you're medium, it's the same logic. You're going to end up in medium at 2022 with annual crop phosphorus removal. So what that is saying is every year for every crop, assuming it's okay, I can put on that crop's worth of anticipated removal. And what they're doing here is they're phasing you back. In phase one, they're going to let you do 3 years, just like up here. Phase two, they're going to let you do 2 years to get you to 1 year. So when you get to under PMT, when we get to 2022, when it's fully implemented, everybody that's over 150 has some sort of phosphorus restriction, which is different than where we are today. Because the least restriction you're going to have is 3 years worth of crop removal. So the flexibility between low is it's saying I can put it out at different times, where medium is going to still let you do every year you could do crop removal for 3 years. You're going to put the same amount of P on here over 3 years this guy did, but here you're going to spoon feed it. A little bit this year, a little bit next year, a little bit next year. So those are things you just got to be aware of. And if you are doing more than this now, that's the effect that it may have on you. So if you know this meets your farm, you need to be talking to your consultant, you need to be having these conversations. Key is, again, it's only going to affect the fields where PMT or PSI is needed. So you may have 20 fields, and maybe only three of them are over 150. It's only affecting them three. So it's only them three we got to do something different with. So hopefully it's not saying I can no longer use any manure, period. It's just maybe less on those fields.
Point out that this data for the tiers
is taken like 2016. It mainly is going to affect, in this case, my example is going to be the ones that are in group A, because they have the lowest soil tests already. They've got 4 years before they're going to go to that. And they may have some soil tests that are just above 150 that may drop to, say, 130, 140. If this isn't locked in, it may apply that they're not now going to do a PMT on that. So it can change because you've got some years in between new nutrient management plans and soil tests before then.
Right. I guess the comment was made. Again, we're putting you in the implementation schedule or the tier grouping based on data that we had submitted that in a perfect world, it was probably 2012 to 2015 soil test data. It was something current. Some cases, the ones we're getting later, they might be 2016 data. So whatever data we use to put you in that tier that says, I've got at least one field over 150. Let's just say you're sitting right on the fence and you're 152. Well, you're in it. And what I guess the comment is made, next year, 2 years from now, I take a soil sample, it might drop to 148. Guess what? PMT don't apply to you today because you're less than 150. So it's not a locked in, it's kind of a work as you go. But if you have to implement it, that's where you are. And I'm assuming we're gonna have some that when they submitted the data didn't have any less than one or any over 150, but next year you get one that's over 150 because maybe you rent another farm or maybe something else changes. I guess we'll figure out how we're going to implement that one as we go, but we're still going to ultimately try to get to 2022 PMT implementation. There is some stuff built into the regs about lack of resources and something and something and something. It could be extended to give us a little more time, but that's kind of where we are.
Question.
Yes, sir.
For a period, they said, okay, crop removal. That's sort of stupid, isn't it? I mean, the crop removing the phosphorus from the field. That's what we planted. You know, that's the reason it's there. That's the reason we planted crop. So if you said crop removal and it's over 150, what are you going to do? Just sit there and let it grow off the bay like they're all worried about?
No, right. I think I understand what you're saying, but what this is saying is if we're limiting you to crop removal, there's a number. At this point, we're using what's generally, I think, from the University of Maryland, but we've got a table that says if your soil test is 150 or greater, the university recommendation for agronomics is saying you don't need any P, zero. You got a plenty there to grow your crop. So you may not put any on, but if you're trying to put P on because I'm trying to get rid of chicken litter, I'm, for whatever reason, adamant to think I need phosphorus, and if you can show it's not an environmental risk, we're going to let you, but what the restriction is saying, if we grow 50 bushel of beans, if that's our anticipated crop, my memory is beans is a pound of P per bushel. So in that scenario, your crop removal that we're anticipating will be physically removed from that field when you put the beans in the truck and you haul them down the road is 50 pounds. What we're saying is we'll let you put 50 pounds on to maintain your soil test phosphorus level. I mean, that's the logic is what it's saying is long term, we're going to maintain where we are, but we're not going to keep going up. I mean, that's the intent of it.
I'd like to bring up on that,
and that is, I had a field about 12 acres that not had any manure or anything for over 50 years. The cows left 50 years ago. Every soil sample showed it high in phosphorus. Okay, all it had on soybeans and wheat. 5 years ago, I decided there's 3 tons of chicken manure out there. My last soil sample showed phosphorus perfect. It went down after I put chicken manure. And all I can get from the experts is what was tied up in the soil. How tied up in the soil, how do you know how much phosphorus is there to get there?
Right. The comment was made, he's had a small field that for years has been showing excessive phosphorus levels, hadn't been putting any phosphorus on it. It sounded like growing beans and wheat, whatever. Chose to put some 3 tons of chicken litter, I think you said, or put some chicken litter on it. And grew corn, and since then his phosphorus level seems to be normal. To me, that's a sampling issue. 9 times out of 10, someone's changed something. Somebody's probably changed something. I think I can't envision the chicken manure had an effect to lower the phosphorus level. But right, and that's probably something other than phosphorus. That's my gut feeling, but I don't know details about that.
Just one soil sample.
Right. But those are the things. I mean, everything, it's not a perfect world we live in, trust me. I mean, we work in. Again, just to jump to something else, these are some latest regulation changes from department in nutrient management. Basically went into effect in the last couple months. One key one is manure, which is basically anything that's not commercial fertilizer. So it applies to sludge or compost or whatever. Is no longer required to be incorporated into the soil. And if you were here probably 4 or 5 years ago, I told you all got to incorporate within 48 hours. That has changed. And next slide, we're going to elaborate on that a little more, but that is something that has changed. If you have to spread manure, generally it's geared to a dairy, somebody that's putting liquid in a lagoon, you got limited places you can store it, you can't stack it in a pile in a field. Fall spreading dates have been extended to now to December the 15th, and that's throughout the state. If you can remember, if you felt looked at it, previous couple years, we were on the Eastern Shore, restricted to November the 1st or 5th, I forget, 2nd, something. And then the Western Shore had a November the 15th date, which never made any sense from the get-go, but that's where the regulations originally that said we had to deal with that in the fall, because basically what happens is you get past fall time frame, and then someone says, well, now it's winter, which made more restrictions. So they've opened up what I call the fall window with the intent of trying to get more manure that maybe needs to be spread in the fall versus having to try to deal with it in February when we got a crisis, you know, because the logic is, one, the fall seemed to be getting extended. We seem to be warmer longer. You're trying to avoid having to build these monstrosity storage structures to hold manure from November 1 till March 1, you know. So now it's, in theory, December the 15th through March 1. Again, manure or anything organic, even commercial fertilizer really, cannot be applied from December the 16th through February 28th. That's the winter time frame. Like I say, it was running November. Again, spreading can resume March 1. We're here, so I'm sure somebody's probably spread chicken manure somewhere already or something, but I haven't seen it yet. But the exception to that is if it's an emergency, and an emergency is I got a lagoon, I got a tank, I got something that's containing it today, but we got a problem that something's happened, and if we don't do something soon, we're going to have an issue. You know, it's going to run out. So in those scenarios, it's an emergency. We're going to work with you. We're going to try to get you through that scenario. The way the regulations previously were spelled out, it didn't even give us that option. If we did anything after November the 5th, we technically were breaking the law, even in an emergency. So that was a help. Or if you have less than 50 animal units, 1,000 pounds of livestock. So if you're a dairy and, you know, they average 1,000-pound cows and you got 49 of them, you got until 2020. That was in the original thing. It's just giving the smaller guys a little more time to get winter storage if you don't already have it. This is actually what the regulations say about no longer having to incorporate. The department's desire and hope is most people are going to still incorporate, but it's no longer mandated. And it was to do with, we've all heard the buzzing about the soil health, and somebody up here this morning talked about, you know, I've been long-term no-tiller, blah, 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 and you're coming, and I want to use manure, I've been using manure, and now you're telling me I'm going to destroy my soil structure, so forth and so on. So, yeah, that's what we've been telling you. So all of that together, maybe just trying to help people out to some degree, the incorporation thing backed up. But here's what it says. Organic nutrient sources shall be injected or incorporated as soon as possible, but no later than 48 hours after application. That's kind of where it used to stop. Now it says, except those farm operations that choose to manage their farms to obtain the benefits of no-till farming. So the intent of that is, if you're going to do tillage, you know you're going to do tillage, you're required to incorporate in 48 hours. But if you're no-till, going to do no-till, that's what you're doing, then you can choose to not incorporate. So it's kind of like the incorporation is voluntary. So that's where we are. So that's new, brand new. Again, needless to say, in the regs, they left the right for MDA to require incorporation on a case-by-case basis. The intent of that is if you're stinking up the world and people are having a hissy fit, you're probably going to get required to incorporate to help mitigate the circumstance. But that's, we haven't crossed that bridge yet. Again, the fall spreading dates now the same, no matter what part of the state you're in, they're all going to play from September the 10th through December the 15th is considered that fall window. Winter is the 16th through the end of February, again, unless you're in emergency or less than 50 animal units. Basically, all nutrient applications that are made in the fall or in the winter, assuming you're allowed to be out there in the winter, need to be applied to an existing crop or vegetative cover. In other words, you can't just go put it on soybean residue. That's not considered acceptable. In other words, if you know you're going to have to spread manure December the 1st, because that's your plan, you're thinking, well, I'm going to spread some in September, but I'm going to try to get my storage empty in December, to hopefully have plenty of room till March. You would have to have your cover planted, because it says you have to have your cover established no later than November the 15th. So in that scenario, you had to plan ahead. In other words, if you're spreading manure November the 1st, you can spread the manure and then plant the cover crop. If you're spreading manure November the 16th, in a perfect world, you would plant the cover crop the day before you put the manure on. So it wants to get cover, it's trying to have cover growing or cover there when you're making that manure application. So you got to do a little planning ahead if that's the scenario. Nothing's changed as far as chicken litter. It's considered stackable. It's not, you know, so we've got restrictions even in the fall of putting it out. In other words, we can't put chicken litter out in the fall without a need. If I got a need to fill, to grow my wheat, to grow my barley, that's one thing. But just to put it out early, to give it a place in the field for next year's corn, that's not legal. Never have, you know, it's not, and that hasn't changed. This is geared to the guy that has a product that's considered not stackable. In our world, that's less than 65% moisture. So it's really liquid. What was added also into this, again, new cover by the 15th. Again, no nutrient applications to fallow ground regardless of crop residue. Was added into this regulation, no spreading on frozen ground. And they put the word, or they put the 2 inches in there. And that's assuming you got 2 inches of frozen ground. You're not allowed out there at any time. Or snow covered 1 inch or greater, and that's any time of the year. So for snow on the ground and more than an inch, not supposed to be out there in the state of Maryland now. They added again the emergency winter applications again. And if you have to, if we're doing stuff in the winter, we're working with people, but in that scenario, they got to do a 100-foot setback from surface water. So we're limiting where they can spread maybe to some degree during that winter period. So may change a few things in some scenarios. Again, applications that are required in an emergency due to an imminent overflow of a storage facility. It's, again, it's focused only on on-farm generated manure. They like to use the word organic fertilizer, but it's manure. In other words, you can't be bringing this problem to your location by importing food processing waste, some kind of biosolids. In other words, they don't get that winter emergency application. They got to find a place to hang on to it. Again, if you're in that situation, operators are going to be required to enter into an agreement of intent with the department that you're working with the Soil Conservation District or some private entity that's basically working towards getting you adequate storage to deal with this in the future. Assuming this is, you got limited storage. In other words, we've got situations that the guy's got maybe 2 months worth of storage. So he's got to get to the point he's probably got to have 4 months worth of storage. So in the interim, he's going to be allowed to spread in the winter under the emergency, assuming we're working towards getting that fixed. That's the intent of that. Operators, again, if you're working in an emergency, you're supposed to contact MDA, nutrient management specialists, like me in this region, for guidance. Again, if you're doing it in the winter, under the emergency, rates may not exceed 1 year's worth of phosphorus removal of the crop you're getting ready to grow, or 50 pounds of plant available in. So in other words, they put a restriction on you that says you can't go out there and just have at it. You got to cut your rates back. Again, anything that goes out in the winter, any winter applied organic nutrients will be deducted from your spring recommendation. So if you're going out there in the winter, you're taking a chance. And if you say, well, I just put 50 pounds of N on December the 16th because I had to, that's 50 pounds you don't get to make up for your corn crop next spring. In other words, it's trying to say, you need to fix this. I mean, that's the intent of that. Again, you can't do it in the winter if the slope's greater than 7%. Don't think that bothers most of us down here. And again, you're going to have a 100-foot setback from surface water and maintain it as such. In other words, you can go back after March 1 and maybe then do this within the 100-foot, depending on what your circumstance is. But in the winter, you got to stay away from the water. Just to change gears slightly, just give a little synopsis of what we're doing every day or what I'm doing. On-farm implementation reviews, again, we're doing them year-round in fiscal year 16. Throughout the state, MDA did 1,022. 739 of them are what we call totally random. In other words, we didn't go there with any suspicion of something. 283 were targeted, and that's generally from something we either see on the annual report, someone's complaining, blah, 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 blah. So we go there with something in our mind that there's probably a problem, could be a problem. From the random review, 66% were in compliance, targeted reviews, 46%. So it kind of pans out that, you know, when we went, when we thought there was a problem, we had more issues than we did. Again, it's ultimately a review of your latest nutrient management plan generally, compared against your nutrient application records. That's what a review is. It's looking at, sitting down and saying, here's what your plan said we were supposed to be doing. Here's what your records showing we're doing. We're making some comparisons. We're making some judgment calls. And we're leaving you with guidance that says, hey, you're doing a good job, or you got a problem, and here's what we got to work towards, so forth, so on. You know, you could be your plan's expired is an issue. Your plan is incomplete is an issue. Incomplete could be, I don't have all my acres in it. It could be, it's only written for commercial fertilizer, but I'm using chicken manure. Those are issues. Or it could just be flat out, you over applied greater than the parameters of what we feel is acceptable. Those are things that can get you out of compliance. Some things you can fix in the short term. Some things are going to take a little while. We're going to do a little follow-up. If you have buffers needed in your nutrient application, setback buffers are needed in some cases. They should be spelled out in your plan. If it ain't spelled out in your plan, then I don't expect you to know about it. You know, but if it's in your plan, then I'm expecting you to implement it. Some cases we may have to look at that. Again, just looking at my region, which is Kent, Queen Anne's, Talbot counties, in 16, I did 130 reviews, 85% compliance. So you can pat yourself on the back. We got better compliance here than, you know, we're helping the rest of the state. So if you take our 85 and put their 50 in it, that's how you get 60. So we're doing a pretty good job, you know. Keys to all this, keep your nutrient management plans current and up to date. Keep records of all nutrient applications that you make, whether it's fertilizer, manure, sludge, whatever it is. And again, hopefully you've applied them according to your plan. In other words, you didn't put on more than what you're planning. You can certainly apply less. Keep records of yields that you're harvesting, because that's what we're using to judge to say, hey, your plan is reasonable and it's acceptable to some degree. It's supporting what you're doing. Again, you follow setback applications if it's a requirement in your plan, and then keep your nutrient applicator voucher current if that's relevant. And that's if you're spreading nutrients of any sort on 10 acres or more in the course of a year. Starter fertilizer, I run into that. And they say, well, I'm only putting on a starter fertilizer on. Yeah, but you did more than 10 acres. You got to have it. Make sure you sign the sign-in sheet if that's relevant. If you need to get updated or if you need to get a new one, sign that sheet that's back there. One that says on the top nutrient management, not the one that says pesticide, because they're two different ones. They're going to go two different directions. This I know you can't read, but I figured, well, I'll put it up there. And Jimmy talked about it briefly in his. This is nothing more than the form that we have that we've had for years. It was modified a little bit last year. And it's a form that we need you to fill out with us if you want to do some kind of research, education, something, and you want to do something that's going to step out of bounds of your nutrient management plan. In other words, I want to try something new, and I know that it's going to potentially cause me to put 25 pounds, 50 pounds more nitrogen to the acre than was needed. Or I want to try to put 100 pounds of nitrogen an acre on soybeans, not 50. To be legal, we need this form filled out. It's basically, in a sense, saying you're going to do replicated plots. You're going to share data with us. We're hopefully all going to learn together, blah, 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 blah. In other words, this is your hopefully giving you an opportunity to try some new things and still be legal. I mean, it's got limitations. You know, we're not going to let you go to the moon, but, you know, it's there. It's available. You need to talk to your specialist nutrient management because we're strongly encouraging that. This year, I only know I have one in my region, but there was two or three in the state. There's not many. It's things like Green Seeker is one. I mean, that was the one that I had, you know, and it's the Green Seeker, you know, everybody's intent and thought is we're going to put on less, but there's a chance we're going to put on more, you know, than my plan. So you got to cover yourself in this scenario. I mean, that's kind of what the intent of that is. And I think you got to do it for 3 years. It's ringing a bell. So in other words, it's trying to get some research type replicated work together. That's basically all I've got. My contact information, phone numbers, emails, address. Again, I'm here to try to help. Key right now is annual reports, due a couple days ago. I didn't want to lie to you and give you a number to tell you how many I had, because I don't know. As of a week ago, I had like 40-some percent.
I got 73.
This man said he got 73%, but I've got stacks in the last 5 days that are probably going to equal that, you know. So I'm going to guess I'm 75, 80%, but I ain't had a chance to get them all computed. And that's typical. Typically, we get to the deadline, we got about 70%, give or take a little, which means we got to work to get the other 30%. Anybody else got any more questions, comments?
Yeah, you were,
as long as they're not too harsh.
You were talking about setbacks from standing water. This year, they come out and told me I can't plant within 30 feet of my ditches, which are dry half the year. And suddenly, I've got a setback on these. They've always been classified as ditches since about 150 years. Now they're suddenly streams. What rule did you come up with to decide they were streams?
The sentiment's comment is, I guess he said they, and I'm assuming they is their
his nutrient management consultant.
Which
In this case, is through extension, I'm assuming. Okay. Basically, saying now he's got something that said you got to have a setback for nutrient application.
That's correct.
Correct. And that word was probably 35 foot.
That's one, well, somewhere in that area.
Okay. And what the regulation says, assuming that thing is considered surface water in our world, and your consultant hopefully is the one helping to determine that. But in cases like this where there's some concern of indiscrepancy, I mean, we're certainly willing to look at it and give it another look, you know, because again, it's some judgment calls in here to some degree. But the university, the person that's writing your plan, are looking at a map. I don't want to tell you which one because I can't answer that specifically, but they're using some kind of tool that someone thinks this is surface water. Surface water, in our definition of needing a nutrient application setback, is it flows water 365 days a year.
These ditches do not do that. They don't do that.
Unless it's a natural, perennial, or intermittent stream. So based on what you're telling me, it doesn't sound like you should have to have a setback. But I.
And it's not a tax ditch rule.
Right, that's correct. Unless it's somebody else's rule, like he said, like tax ditch. I mean, that wouldn't be us per se. And what it would, assuming you need a setback, is 10 foot of permanent vegetation. It's 35 foot of no broadcast NNP. So assuming you need a setback, it says you can't plant a crop closer than 10 feet. It says you can't broadcast NNP. When I say broadcast, you can't sling it. Manure spreader, dry fertilizer, but you can spray it out of a boom. That's
not good sense to, so the ditch anyway.
Correct. So that's it, assuming you need a setback, that's where it comes in. But in your case, we can look into it a little more.